Turn it on. If everyone can begin to take their seats, please.
I would like to call the meeting to, I'd like to call the meeting to order. And I do want to remind everyone that this meeting is being taped and will be posted on the Carroll County website. Okay, can we establish a quorum?
Mr. Soyson?
Here.
Ms. Cheatwood?
Here.
Mr. Canale?
Here.
Mr. Wathers?
Here.
Mr. Yeo?
Here.
Mr. Huff?
Here.
Ms. Kirpner? Secretary Eisenberg?
Present.
Mr. Chair, please let the record reflect that six members are present and we do have a quorum.
Thank you. Can we stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we start, I'd like to make a few introductions. I believe Commissioner Wentz and Commissioner Rothschild are here, so welcome. And we have a few primary election candidates, Ed Rothstein and Eric Boucher. Congratulations, by the way. Okay. Linda, would you like to proceed with the process and guidelines?
Yes. So again, thank you all for being here this evening. I'm just going to quickly go over the public hearing agenda. Obviously, we just had the opening remarks by the chair. And then we're going to go over the code of conduct for the public hearing. I'm going to do a brief overview of the plan of where we are since the remanded plan for those of you that have been following. And then we will do a call to order for the testimony, and then we'll conclude the hearing. So just to review the code of conduct, that speakers wishing to speak, you all should have filled out a comment card. Through the course of this, if you want to go out and bring a new comment card in, you can give them to Mary Lane, and she will go ahead and bring them up to us. So just because you haven't filled out one now, if you decide that you want to speak toward the end of the public hearing, you're more than welcome to do so. We ask that you only take 3 minutes. We will have a timer. At the end of the 3 minutes, we will excuse you so that way we can get on to the next speaker. And we ask that you not yield your time to another speaker. If someone has another prepared portion that follows your presentation, but you can't say that I'm now going to give up my time and give it to the next person, so someone else has 6 minutes to speak on a topic. And we also ask that you be respectful and not disparage people or to use unkind words or unkind language with regards to Planning Commission members, commissioners, or staff. This is really to hear about the remanded 2018 Freedom Plan and is not to be in a personal attack on anyone. And that we also show no hand clapping or cheers or anything like that for what a speaker has said. We don't want to intimidate future speakers from saying something that may be opposite of what you've been speaking about to make sure that everyone is in a comfortable environment. And if you don't comply with these guidelines, we would ask that you sit down, and we don't want to have anyone gaveled for being out of conduct. So with that, I'm going to go over the comprehensive plan, where we ended up, and why we're here today. As many of you here, there's a lot of familiar faces, are aware we've been working on this plan for quite some time, for many years. We were pretty much here almost a year ago to the date for this public hearing as well for the comprehensive plan. And the Board of County Commissioners did take that plan under consideration. And in October of 2017, decided it was time to remand the plan back to Planning Commission to make some adjustments to the plan that was presented to them. They asked the Planning Commission to consider revisions to the vision statement, revisions to the land use definitions, and revisions to review the significant land use changes to the plan. So again, what we've been doing throughout this whole process is looking at concurrence of the plan, which happened years ago with the various chapters of the plan, and then Planning Commission endorsed those various chapters. And so now we're in the acceptance portion of the plan, meaning that Planning Commission has a draft that they wanted to put out for review to the public. This plan has been out for more than 60 days. It went out publicly on May 9th, but Planning Commission accepted the plan in April of 2018. After tonight's public hearing, Planning Commission will go back and on their meeting on Tuesday of next week, we'll discuss the comments from tonight's hearing and make decisions based on that and how to move forward the plan. Their option is to approve the plan and forward it to the Board of County Commissioners, and then the County Commissioners are the body that adopts the plan. So the vision statement that was approved in January of 2018 reads as follows, that the Freedom Area provides a quality of life that promotes a safe community dedicated to education and preservation of the rural and natural environment, as well as promoting economic development and growth by supporting balanced commercial areas and a variety of housing options while protecting the integrity of the community's identity and sense of place. Planning Commission worked through various meetings to write the nuanced new version of the vision statement. The Board of County Commissioners just wanted the vision statement to have a different feel to it, and this is what Planning Commission, based on the recommendations of the board, decided to move forward within this version of the plan. Also, future land use definitions were approved by the Planning Commission on March of 2018. Again, many meetings were held, and this new set of definitions were discussed, and some of the instructions given by the Board of County Commissioners was to really beef up what the primary purpose of the land use designation was, to give more exact types of uses that are generally permitted in those districts, to set out a typical density for the residential development, and to denote if water and sewer service is necessary for the type of development to occur as its future land use designation would suggest. And then finally, the Planning Commission also looked at residential medium and residential high future land use designations and looked at different types of housing that could be applied on those properties and look at redeveloping the current planned unit development ordinance that we have in our current zoning code. We actually have a PUD for short proposal that's in our current zoning code. This is a new proposal put forth that modifies what we have existing. And that modification, which is found in Appendix H of the plan, sets a minimum acreage at 50 acres. Our current PUD is at 100 acres. It will require public water and sewer to be utilized. Areas designated and clearly delineated in the plan are those that would be high-density residential or residential medium, so that plan unit development would be applicable in those future land use categories, and that the plan unit development would alter the density, allowing 3.5 dwelling units per acre in residential medium, which is typically a 2-unit per acre zoning district if it was R20,000. And for our existing high densities, it would not change the allowable density, so that those densities would stay the same. And it would limit townhouses permitted in the residential medium district and limit townhouses and multifamily to the commercial to the residential high only. So you wouldn't see multifamily, traditionally apartments or condo units in the residential medium, but you would see townhomes allowed in that district if the PUD is utilized. It's not necessary. And this is just a recommendation for the Board of County Commissioners to consider in the implementation phase, meaning the rezoning effort of the plan. So the plan does not do this automatically. It would happen when in some future date and time when we begin to implement the plan through zoning mechanism, which is regulatory, that the Board of County Commissioners would consider whether or not to make modifications to the current code as it stands with regard to plan unit development. This is just a recommendation and a guideline for the commissioners to consider when that time comes in the future. And I have a zoomed in version of this map, but this was the 2017 accepted future land use map. So this was the map that the Board of County Commissioners took up when they were given the plan this time last year. With those current land use designations. So over the last 9 months or so, Planning Commission has gone through and discussed these land use designations and made several modifications based on the recommendations of the Board of County Commissioners. So I know the colors aren't great here, and I apologize. The lights kind of muddle things out, but I'm going to put the two side by side, and the red circled areas show you where the major changes occurred. So in the 2017 version of the plan, one thing that was considered was very low density residential to be considered on properties where neighborhoods had developed really out of our conservation zoning and were less like conservation and more like residential development. So the very low density land use category, which was also used in the master plan, was utilized in this port, was utilized in the Freedom Plan as well to denote the same things. But the board requested that those be put back to what they were in 2000. So in this area, it was agriculture, and we had removed the agriculture in the 2017 plan and put very low density residential and resource conservation. And this community is Bartholow Road, and that's the Pooldale Farm and some other offshoot communities. So that went back to its agricultural land use designation that it was in 2001 for this new iteration. As well as the Obreck Road area. A lot of communities developed out of ag and resource conservation to low-density residential, but that designation was removed and reverted back to agriculture, as well as properties off of 97 toward Patapsco Valley State Park, as well as some state parkland went back from conservation back to agriculture. So those were that concept that was altered back to what it was originally. As well as there's a lot of discussion, as you all are aware, of the property along Bennett Road and terminates at Progress Way, known as the Beatty property. And in the version of the plan that the commissioners considered in the 2017 version was to have medium density residential and commercial high. Planning Commission went back and had discussions and made it all residential high density. And if the PUD were to be utilized as it is recommended in the plan, that that could be utilized and have a mixed use type of center with a commercial also on that particular property. As well as properties to the west, this is where Liberty Exchange is and some properties to the south. These were changed just because Liberty Exchange is more in agreement with where the commercial high would be than its current industrial zoning district. So that was more of a technical change. Properties to the south of that, landowner request, because again, the plan was opened again. So landowners did come forward and say, would you, you know, maybe consider during this iteration of the plan looking at our property and seeing how it fits into the context. So properties that were looked at were across from Liberty Exchange for a commercial medium land use designation. As well as we did some technical changes along 32 near Bennett and Progress. Again, the post office property and the Merritt property are more in alignment with where the current commercial high is as opposed to the current industrial, which they're zoned now. And there's been a lot of transition in this area where things have been industrially zoned in the past, but because of different conditional use approvals, as we discussed in the plan since the beginning, recognizing them as more in a commercial light because of either rezoning cases or conditional use approvals from an industrial use to a more of a commercial use. As well as property owners along Streaker and White Rock Road and Obreck Road came forward saying that they would like to be considered from agricultural to residential medium. So this property and the property to the west, Planning Commission discussed and deliberated looking into the long-term future, as one of the maps shows out in the hall, that if water and sewer could be available in the future, that these could be potential properties for residential medium land use, as well as a property south of there along 97 for low-density land use. But again, this is a 30-year plan. This is not envisioned to what's going to happen tomorrow, but over the course of 30 years, this is where the plan would like to see it go, but doesn't necessarily happen in those 30 years. And that's one thing that we try to use the anticipated timing map to say, okay, well, we know that we have water and sewer in this particular area, so it is foreseen that some of the properties could develop more rapidly, but others are far out into the future and is the long-term vision and goal. These plans are reset every 10 years, so if that's still the vision and goal in 10 years from now, then those properties may stay the same if that haven't developed. But if that's not where the long-term vision and goal still continues, then that's why we reevaluate these plans every 10 years. So I think that's all the major highlights with regards to the changes from the remanded plan. And with that, if you'd like to call the hearing to order now, that's all I have for you.
It is 20 after 6, so we will open the public hearing.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call the number and the name, and then I'm going to call the next person in line to be on deck to be ready to speak. So if you could alternate microphones as best you can, just so we can keep the public hearing flowing, that would be wonderful. And I will try to pronounce people's names correctly. So with that, I'd like to call number one, Lewis Toth, up to the microphone. And then at the next microphone, Jennifer Meyer.
Hello, my name is Lewis Toth. A business partner and I own four lots on the east end of Liberty Road. The address is 2105 Liberty Road. Three of the lots are zoned BNR, and one is zoned a split zone, BNR and R20. We are planning to consolidate the four lots into one and develop it for a principal permitted use in the BNR district. We are currently negotiating with a buyer to develop the site. I have two comments. The proposed use is allowed under BNR, the purchaser's proposed use, but is not specifically listed in the new zoning. We think that the use currently allowed in the BNR district should be grandfathered in, as we are in the process of negotiating with a developer and beginning the site plan process. The second comment is, the fourth lot on the east end of the property is currently split zoned and is not shown on the comprehensive map as being BNR. So we ask that at least the front half of that property be included in the comprehensive zone. Any questions regarding that?
No.
Thank you.
And then on deck, Lisa May, number three.
The speaker.
The tech crew will be working on that.
Go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Meyer. My husband, Nick Meyer, my two little girls just recently became Carroll County residents. About a month ago. We're the newest members of the Long Meadow community. Literally from my front porch can see the development that will be occurring over the next several years. Prior to moving to Carroll County, we lived in Newtown Owings Mills, less than 2 miles away from the quarry. And as we watched the quarry develop, we watched as the crime went up, the violence went up, and worst of all, the schools declined. In fact, the first offer that we had when we tried to sell our house was withdrawn after they researched the school in the district. We moved to Carroll County for the schools. My oldest daughter starts in the fall, kindergarten. Prior to living in Owings Mills, I lived in Ellicott City, miles away from Turf Valley. And I know that both of these properties are ones that you've considered for the high density and residential planning of the development of the property. And I can tell you in both places from personal experience, it does not bring a better quality of life for the residents around it. I implore you to think carefully about bringing in high density residential, because it'll be great. Those condos, townhouses, apartments, they'll sell out quickly. And then in 5 years, the school systems will rapidly decline, which is the reason that everyone comes to Carroll County. I implore you to think about that, because making the money on the taxes, while it brings in income to the county, I don't know if it's worth gambling on the future of the children in this county. I want to conclude by saying that I heard that Sykesville was voted coolest small town in America a couple years ago. I truly believe that it was cool because it doesn't have big development like this. It's unique because it doesn't pack people in. It attracts the right combination of people that truly appreciate the land, the nature, the schools, the people. Please just consider that making Sykesville and this specific area, like every other county and district in Maryland, isn't exactly a benefit. Thank you.
I'd like to call Richard France, number 4, on deck, please.
Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Commission, my name is Lisa May, and I'm the Government Affairs Director for the Carroll County Realtors. CCR is an organization which represents over 600 real estate professionals who live and work here in Carroll County. First, we want to thank you for being here, from hearing from the community once again on the Freedom Plan. We have submitted formal comments for the record, but we felt that it was important to be here in person to again state our support for the Freedom Plan. The bottom line is that Carroll's current housing stock is not meeting the needs of its residents, particularly seniors and young professionals who are looking to start their families here in Carroll County. We say this because residential construction is not keeping pace with the jobs that we're creating here in the county. Our housing prices are appreciating at a much faster pace than our wages. The average first-time buyer in the county cannot afford the county's average starter home, and in fact would have to save for 20 years in order to get a 20% down payment. Finally, the vast majority of our growing senior population has expressed the desire to age in place here in the county. But if we continue our large home and large lot development process, it's going to prevent many of them from being able to do that. If we continue doing what we've always done, we're essentially telling our seniors and our young professionals that Carroll County is not the place for them any longer. Further, the county is going to have real difficulties in attracting quality employers here to Carroll County once they find out that their workers don't have any place to go. So if we want to change this, we need modest proposals to provide additional housing options. We believe that the Freedom Plan is one of those modest proposals. It's going to allow our residents to call Carroll County home at every stage of their lives, but also protect the character and the sense of community that sets Carroll County apart from other jurisdictions. So again, realtors ask for your support of the Freedom Plan. Thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you have.
And on deck, number 5, Adam Sproul.
Good evening. My name is Richard France. I'm annoyed. We're smarter than you think we are. Things like your vision statement.
Please.
Truthfully, things like your vision statement saying economic development and growth supported by balanced commercial areas and a variety of housing options. We see right through this thinly veiled excuse of plan. Your 17 PUD, your proposal, Appendix H, which you just highlighted, removing commercial from the Beatty property, and then rezoning it with your new plan, the revision for residential high to include commercial in a future revision of the PUD, it's the same thing. We see through this. My neighborhood, I live backing up to the Wolf Farm. People are moving out of my neighborhood because they know what's coming, and it's horrible. They're moving out fast. I'm in a unique position. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know whether to fix my house and live in it, the same house I grew up in, we've owned for 40 plus years, or to fix it up and sell it. And a lot's going to ride on what you choose to do here.
Adam Sproul, and then on deck, Linda Coyne.
Good evening. My name's Adam Sproul. I want to talk about the highly anticipated high-density area. We currently have Blue Ribbon schools in the area with students that were recently recognized by the state governor. I mean, this is a really big deal. This is out of 1,300 kids in the entire state. We are already at our limits for the funding of these schools, especially with myself having two children needing special needs involvement with the IDP program. Our infrastructure needs a massive overhaul, as most areas don't have fiber optics, they have old power lines, old power systems, and old power networks. Gas is not accessible to the majority of the people in Eldersburg and Sykesville, and the sewer systems are aging. We have poor runoff areas, bad road design that encouraged flooding. With the development, we have already seen flooding in older areas to include downtown Sykesville. I don't want this to turn into how Ellicott City's gotten flooded twice with record flood levels. The high-density areas are known for the burden on their community. Point to the quarry, with once it recently developed, crime increased and the overall infrastructure wasn't improved. I want to know what the plans are to aid the community before the burden is placed on the community. Now, I've been a resident for over 30 years. I'm a veteran, I've been across the world, and I've seen what good infrastructure can do to a community and what bad infrastructure does to a growing populace. I don't see any plans to improve the quality of life for the current residents before bringing in new residents. Thank you.
Next is Linda Coyne, and on deck, Cheryl Jenkins.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Let me pull down a little more.
A little bit more?
Yeah.
Okay, thanks. Good evening. My name is Linda Coyne. I am one of 70 owners and residents of the Homeland Condominiums in Eldersburg and co-chairman of the 17-member Homeland Focus Committee. Today may be a new day, but the 67 residents and owners who signed the Homeland Survey dated September 2017 have not changed their position. The Lores Avenue property and 1503 Liberty Road should stay as zoned neighborhood retail business or the new zoning classification C1 with the maximum store size of 10,000 square feet. Since November of 2016, our community has submitted to the county officials and departments petitions, letters, emails, formal written comments, phone calls, and verbal testimony stating that we are adamantly opposed to construction of large-scale commercial development with asphalt parking lots, commercial lighting, noise from cars and trucks all day, all hours of the day and night, air pollution, inadequate stormwater management, and increased crime in our neighborhood. Think forward. When you are in your 70s or 80s and the property next to your home is being rezoned as commercial high with buildings over 100,000 square feet, or if your mother or your father has to deal with commercial development 25 feet from their doorstep. How would you feel? That is why I hope the Planning Commission, the Planning Department, and the five commissioners have our same goals in mind: to maintain the character of our peaceful, beautiful community, preserve our safety and security with measured commercial development to protect the quality of life for current and future residents of Homeland and Eldersburg. Thank you.
Cheryl Jenkins, next up, Stan Prowser.
Hello, my name is Cheryl Jenkins and I'm a resident of the Homeland Condominiums. It has been called to my attention that some of our county representatives may be confused about the number of residents at Homeland who are in agreement with the development of the Lohr's property. A recent statement in the Carroll County Times stated the residents at Homeland were split 50-50. I don't know who or where this information was obtained or where the evidence is to support this statement. There are a total of 70 units at Homeland. I submit to you, as been submitted to you before, a copy of a survey with 67 signatures of residents at Homeland who are not in agreement with the proposed zoning, thus development of the Lohr's property. Do the math. 70 units, 67 opposition signatures. This is by no means split 50-50. I hope this survey clarifies where the majority of Homeland residents stand on this issue. Thank you.
And if you want to give that to this young lady here, she'll take that. Thank you. Stan Prowser, next up, Wendy Berger.
Good evening, I'm Stan Prowser, and I'd like to first thank everybody here for coming. I suspect this would not have been your first choice if it hadn't have been for a planning meeting. I moved here in 1974 from Randallstown. No disrespect to Randallstown, I left there to come here. I don't want them coming here, okay? They have a host of issues. It's still a nice place, but there's a host of issues that you all can approve for following us here. There are more important things that can be accomplished besides all the traffic and all the problems that seem to be following into Carroll County and into the Freedom area. I like the fact that this is supposed to be democratic and we're all given a chance, but I'm curious. I'd like to ask the board a question. How many people are in favor of your Freedom planning? Is it a majority? Is it less than a majority? Do you all know? Well, since you don't, I'd like to ask the audience, all you homeowners that are in favor of the new Freedom plan, please raise your hand. What's that, four out of a group that were interested enough to come here? I don't want to waste your time. You've already heard the arguments. I'm smart enough to realize where this is going. But I think with our homes being one of our largest assets that we took the time to build and to nurture, that you give us a little bit more credit and try and go along with the people that have come here and in good faith purchased a home for a quality of life. And I think that's going to be rapidly compromised by the plan here tonight to start putting in all these extra unnecessary necessities. And I can almost, I'm curious, how many of the committee members are from the Freedom area?
None.
If you would do me a favor and give me a general idea where you live, I'd like to go there and see if I can't do the same for you as you're trying to do for me.
So just to I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, that's okay.
No, I was going to say, just to reiterate, this is not an answer and question session. It's just for public testimony.
I can understand why, too. But thank you very much for reminding me.
Next, and Wendy Berger, and on deck, Connie Corpus.
This plan always had major flaws, and although there have been minor tweaks along the way, major fundamental shortcomings still exist. Antiquated zoning definitions that lead to expensive lawsuits, land use regulations that are too broad and invite abuses, inferior infrastructure to support these massive increases in traffic and population. Residents of the Freedom Plan were never allowed to participate in the planning. We were only allowed to react to things that we uncovered ourselves. There's no justification that was ever stated that there's actually a need for any of these changes, and there's no proof that this plan will benefit the community as a whole. You were asked to complete this plan before the current commissioners leave office. I ask you to ignore that time frame, get it done correctly by addressing these devastating fundamental flaws. Thank you.
Next, Connie Corpus, on deck, Lewis Shipley.
I'm not Lois, I'm Connie Corpus.
Yeah, you're next, Connie. Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm Connie Corpus. Hello, everyone. I'm 85. I have six children, six families. We all reside in Carroll County. We had the Frisco Family Pub for almost 30 years, more than 30 years. And my other daughter, one daughter, had a little restaurant on Main Street. My kids all work in Carroll County, various good employment. I live in homeland condos. When I was widowed 12 years ago, I moved there. My kids helped me get in there so I could have a tiny room with a little bit of land. And now, I hate to say it, our land is being taken away from us. We have a family of deer that come, lots of wildlife, and we're gonna lose all but 50 feet behind us. And that will become a parking lot for a shopping center. We'll have the rear end of a shopping center behind us. And I'm very sad that we're going to miss all of the scenery, the trees. All the trees are coming down. It's going to be very sad for us. And it's 70 families in the homeland. And we're all brokenhearted that we're not going to have just a little strip of land between us and a parking lot. And that's about all I can say. Thank you.
Next, Lois Shipley. On deck, Patricia Dorsey.
Hi, I'm Lois Shipley. I have been a resident of Carroll County. My husband and I built our first house on Ridge Road at the end of 1966. We have seen a lot. When we first moved here, my oldest son was in the Cub Scouts. He and another scout set at the intersection of Route 32 and 26. There was SO station there counting cars to see if it warranted a yellow flashing light. So you see the changes that we have made, and through the years, when the time came that we thought we have to settle down, get something smaller, we couldn't do it, take care of anymore. We found this at homeland, two blocks from her house, safe, secure. Our family was happy we were coming there, and it was good for us. But now that we're in the final chapters of our book of life, I feel we should not be subject to sleepless nights wondering who's going to come from behind and start splitting our tires and different things like that. So in my opinion, I feel you're discriminating against the elder, and this is elder abuse. Thank you.
Next, Patricia Dorsey. On deck, Pat Hassany.
Good evening. I was here a year ago, and I've moved here in 1976, so I've seen it grow, and it's still a beautiful place. But when I heard about the new plan being adopted, I went online and checked it out, and I'm looking at both 2001, 2017, I guess it was 18. I saw there was, it was like looking at a bird's eye view, looking down at it. Instead of looking down, I was looking down instead of looking at it. And I realized that some things have not really changed in the whole time I've been here, and one of them is a major thing with development, and it is our roads. Because we're in a unique situation where we have, from the east side on 26, we have a reservoir. And I live right on 32, right before the reservoir, north of there. And that's there. And then we basically, you come into our area, and we have single roads, like one lane each way. And then they'll open up to two lanes, and then they'll go back to one lane. But all these between 26 and 32, they feed through off of like Bennett or Pine Knob. And when I look at the high density where they're going to build those two properties, it's like, well, how is that changing? I haven't seen anything where you can improve the state highways, because you'll come to a reservoir, you got to build another bridge to make it wider. So everything is like, we have single lane roads going each way. For a certain period of time, we'll have two lanes where you can turn where the commercial is. But when you get to certain points, I mean, going down 32 southbound, it becomes a single lane road each way. Going northbound, it's a single lane once you get past, what is it? A little bit past Bennett Road or something. But what I'm saying is, with all this growth, I don't see how the major structures, the transportation is keeping up with all of it. Because you can go through the communities, Bennett Road. I used to walk my dog on Pine Knob, because I come out my house on 32, go left and turn left on Pine Knob. But there's so much traffic there, and there's not much shoulder that I can't walk her there anymore, so I have to cross 32 at certain times. So what I'm concerned about is just things have changed, but they really haven't changed when it comes to people that live here getting around and being safe. And I can tell you, I try to face traffic all the time, because I can't tell you the number of times I've seen people pull over on the side, the shoulder, because they're not paying attention. And I'm just so concerned about all this traffic, and it's like, I just don't see any improvements to the major roads to handle it. So that was all my main concern. I just thought it's a bird's eye view. Thank you.
Next, Pat Kennessy. On deck, Michael Pierpont.
Hi, I'm Pat Hasnine, and I'm new. I have never been here before to any of your meetings. And I live on the south end of Carroll County. And on our side, I don't know how many people really informed, because I talked to people, my neighbors, and they had no idea what's going on. I have also lived here for over 36 years. I can remember when you could hear the crickets at night, and you could smell the air in the summertime, and it was beautiful, and you could see the stars. It was gorgeous out here. I don't hear the crickets anymore, and I really have a hard time seeing the stars. I also concerned about the roads and the construction. Look, I understand we need growth, but let's be smart. We have a beautiful place. My little piece of land that I have is my little sanctuary. And I think a lot of these people have a little piece of sanctuary, a place of peace and quiet away from the craziness of the world. They need a place. We all need a place that we can go. And if you put townhouses and everything, you're taking that away. And the roads, Liberty Road, I am surprised at how much traffic. I was on the road today and I went, can I get to Liberty High School before the meeting? It's bumper to bumper. I remember when it's just one red light and there was hardly nobody out here. Look, I don't know if you've already made up your mind. I have no idea. But I think the people here tonight are pleading with you in many, many ways. I'm almost a senior, and I'm planning on living in this community. Oh, and by the way, when I have moved in here, I never had to lock my doors. My son, that's 33 years old, that was raised in Carroll County, goes, Mommy, when did you start locking your doors? I said, well, we've been having people walking into people's homes lately. So there is the crime rate is starting to move and everything, and now I lock my doors. We have cars that get crashed, you know, windows broken into. So crime is developing. And all I'm saying to the staff, I'm pleading with you and the rest of you, please think about us and care about what you're going to do to us down here at the Carroll County. And I thank you and have a great night.
Next, Michael Pierpont. On deck, James Hillen.
Good evening. I'm Michael Pierpont. I live in the Long Meadow community. I have three basic topics and then a summary of those three. First topic is safety. I do walk every morning up and down Rolling View Drive and throughout that whole area, the Long Meadow Drive area, Blue Spruce, and it's a safe walk. There's not much in the way of traffic. And not only safety from my concern, during my walks, I see a lot of young women pushing baby carriages. You know, I see at least four, perhaps as many as six, every morning. So not only are you going to put a senior citizen like myself in jeopardy of having tons of traffic coming down Rolling View Drive, but how about all those baby carriages? So that's topic number one, is safety. Topic number two is Liberty Road, Maryland Route 26. And as a previous speaker had said, if you look to the east, there is just a complete bottleneck going towards Baltimore County. And those two bridges are more than likely to be one-lane bridges, because as long as I can remember, there's always been some construction. So there's always a mess there. And if you look to the west, it's bottleneck all the way to at least 97. It is so much congestion. Now, I know that's a Maryland state road, but if you're going to put in high-density housing someplace, you better start really thinking about, you know, getting Maryland State to make that a six-lane highway or something. The last topic is money. There's two issues real quick. The first one with money is, why don't you just raise our property taxes? I think we would all appreciate that much more than appeasing multimillionaire developers. Because that's topic number two. I think what this really boils down to is we have a few realtors, but more importantly, we have multi-millionaire developers who can give huge contributions, political campaign contributions, and that's a nice way of saying it. I mean, really what it boils down to is bribery and extortion. You know, is it fake news?
Let's not disparage people.
I'm just telling the truth, Mr. Trump. Anyway, In summary, high density, and this is proven all across the country.
So time is up. High density, finish your thought, please.
Is crime.
Thank you.
Thank you. None of you live here.
Next, James Hillen. On deck, Jane Frazier.
Well, let's see if we can hear ourselves here. This is not going to be as eloquent as some of the speakers you've had here today, for the simple fact that I was thinking about this while I was doing something rather mundane, mowing a lawn. But nevertheless, here we go. Quite a few years ago, and with me, everything is quite a few years ago, being a pretty old coot at that, 83, that's getting there. Anyway, I managed to get through George Washington University with a degree in governmental administration. Now, one of the things that we were taught was that, yes, you need to plan, but you always plan to improve things. Gentlemen, ladies, this is not an improvement. This thing is a regression. It cannot help, it's not going to help traffic. It is not going to help reduce crime. It is certainly going to help to increase crime and cause problems for fire and rescue and all kinds of things. A lot of social problems as well. I think that it's just plain ridiculous. Now, the thing that we should be thinking about is, what is the quality of life now in the area, and how do we keep it, not how do we destroy it? but it seems to me this plan is for the destruction of it, and I'm not very happy with that. Now, as far as shopping centers and so forth, I stopped by Liberty Exchange just before I came here. It's only about a quarter full of businesses, so I really think we don't really need many more shopping centers. One of the grocery stores is pulling out right now, so I don't know what somebody will take their place, I'm sure. But the whole thing is that I think this whole project or this whole method of doing this is backwards. You should have come here first, then talk about it and decide what you could do. Thank you.
Next, Jane Frazier. On deck, Tina Hoff.
Hello. I moved to Maryland from Indiana 2 years ago for a job. I knew the cost of living here was a lot more expensive than Indiana. But overall, that high cost, you see that in housing. I was told when I was hired here to look for housing, but not here, that Pennsylvania would be my best bet, as it was much less expensive to live there and still a close commute, or at least check into surrounding areas, such as Owings Mills, as Carroll County prices are extremely high. However, I really want to live in the same community where I work. I find and I believe that this makes our county stronger. I don't want a house. I work 50 to 70 hours a week, and when I come home, I don't want to do yard work or house maintenance. It's just never been something that I have been interested in. I would prefer an apartment or a townhouse. I like where I currently live. It's safe and secure, good people, great maintenance, etc. But my rent increased by 9%, while my raise was 3%. And this next month, my rent will go up another 9% with a raise that's of 3% again. I have a master's of fine arts degree, 18 plus years experience, a good job, and community is very important to me. But I am currently looking outside of Carroll County, mainly due to rent prices. If the county could supply affordable housing and a variety of housing, then I could stay here and work here and live here and give back to my community, my county. If the county can't do that, I will need to take myself elsewhere, perhaps to a different state, and possibly even to a different job altogether. I would love to stay in this beautiful county, and I promise you all that if I move into your area, I will not bring crime here. Thank you.
Next, Tina Hoff. On deck, Joseph Looking.
My name is Tina Hoff. I live in the county, and generations of my family have always lived in this county, but I gotta be honest, my generation is the first generation of that family who hasn't been able to stay in the county and work in the county because we can't afford to. I work at Carroll Community College with Jane, who just spoke. I took that job because I went there when I was younger and I wanted to come back and serve that community as well, but that's a pay cut. I took that job because I love it and I was allowed to stay here and work that job and live here only because my husband has a small business in the community and actually with his salary I can afford to stay. And I hear a lot of talk about change and I know there's fear behind that and I know that change is frightening. But there's a lot of fear around saying, if we change, suddenly every outsider will end up here. Well, long-term plans, like generations of my family that were in place, allowed many of people in this room probably to move to Carroll County and make a life. You didn't come here to have crime or slash tires. You made a life with your family because long-term plans allowed for room for you to come here. This kind of long-term plan that goes on for years and years may, if done well, allow my children to live here, because right now when I look ahead, one of them's going into high school. He won't be able to afford it. Everyone I know, including those family members, if they work in Carroll County, they live in outside Carroll County because that's the only way they can afford to have a family home. If they decide to try to stay in Carroll County, they work outside the county. They have to go to Baltimore. They have to go to Columbia. They have to commute long distances to afford the house that they have here that they can spend so little time in because they spend so much time traveling. So there's that constant struggle. We can't have people who live and work here and serve here if there's not a long-term plan that allows for the slow process of progress and growth for that to happen. I heard a saying recently that says, any community that's not growing is dying. Is that what we want for Carroll County? That we just stay the same and all of our children leave because they can't find work here? Salaries aren't exactly going up anytime soon. And that's where we could end up. So I'd rather see a long-term plan that allows smart growth and room for our families to stay here because it's not guaranteed anymore. I was born in 1970. It's not guaranteed for anyone in my family's generation and not for any of the people I know. Thank you.
Next, Joseph Lukane. On deck, Heidi Condon.
Hi, I'm Joe Luking, and I've lived here on Hannah Road since 1979. I'm a little upset about the high-density zoning on the properties on Oklahoma and Bennett Road. They don't seem to fit in with anything surrounding it. Everything around it is either medium-density zoning or conservation zoning. To throw high-density into the middle of that does not make a lot of sense to me. The strains it's going to put on both Bennett and Oklahoma Road, the strains it's going to put on the middle school, the elementary schools, it just doesn't make a lot of sense. Thank you.
Heidi Condon. On deck, Beth Gray.
Good evening. My name is Heidi Condon, daughter of the late Raymond Beatty of the Beatty Farm, which our father purchased in 1958. When Longmeadow was being developed in the early 60s, there was no public water or sewer in the area and no zoning. So the lot sizes were limited to 1/2-acre lots. That was to accommodate the well and the septic area. Later, when the water and sewer was run through our property, our father's understanding was that he would be able to develop the remainder of the property in high density, residential, or commercial. Over the years, our neighbors have developed their farms around us. And we did not complain because we knew, as many of you did when you moved here, that Freedom is the high growth development area for Carroll County. excuse me. If we had fought growth, as you were trying to fight growth, most of you would not be here. Okay. Our property will be one of the last to be developed in Freedom. On behalf of my family, I would like to say thank you to the Planning Commission for taking the time to consider the best land use for our property. I know this has been a long and drawn out process for you also. When we first requested commercial and high density residential for our property, much time was spent considering whether commercial or residential was best. Seeing that the property had not developed as industrial over many years, you realized that commercial for the entire property was not likely to work well. You listened to the community, and most recently, you have decided high-density residential is the best land use for our property. It seems to be a fair compromise and may allow for more flexible development once the zoning definitions are all complete. Our family feels that high-density residential is the best use of our property, as our late father, Raymond Beatty, also felt. We appreciate all of the time and energy you have put into making the land use decisions for this designated high-growth development area of Freedom and encourage the commissioners to pass the plan as you have approved it. Thank you.
Next, Beth Gray. On deck, Nick Perrone.
Good evening.
I say no to this plan in its current form because it diverts traffic onto quiet residential roads, using them as replacements for state and county roads. It increases crowding in residential areas, replacing high-density housing where low and medium-density housing exist or has been planned for decades. It strains already overburdened law enforcement, fire, and EMS services with no plans for infrastructure relief. I believe these statements are true because I've been watching, attending, and participating in nearly every planning and zoning meeting on the topic of the Freedom Plan for the past 3 years. 3 years. And because the 2001 plan was not adequately or appropriately implemented, much of the new plan seeks to correct zoning and land use by making it consistent on paper with what exists in reality. However, referring to the plan, the language within the plan, the definitions for land use and category changes are still too difficult to follow. You have to go to an appendix to understand what may or may not be allowed on land, and the definitions are still not complete. Also, passing this plan without knowing what may be possible for any of these parcels is reckless and irresponsible. The ordinances, regulations, and county codes remain decades out of date and out of step in 2018. And there are zero public facility designations in this plan. No schools, no fire departments, no libraries. The previous plan dedicated 7% of the land use map as such. Transportation, which this plan devotes a lot of language to, is also gone. Previously, 5% of the land use was devoted to roads and road improvements. The whole of the transportation element prepared by Peone and Associates was cut and pasted into the plan. This company only did partial traffic study samples, and their own admission, it was an incomplete job. There are multiple problems with multiple intersections, which were not studied, and around which most of the increased density is slated to go. Most of these surround or feed the big five properties in question: Gibson, Wolf, Beatty, the Snowden Run, and Eli properties. This entire document needs to be reviewed by a competent, vetted editor. Did you know that pages 4, 6, and 8 are still blank? There are placeholders only on those pages. The language is uneven and multi-voiced, and it lacks a cohesion. It is hard to read and to understand. Too many terms are ambiguous, and the repetition is tedious. This should be a manual for all people, not a confusing...
Please finish your thought. Your time is up.
Not a confusing paper. If the language can or must be interpreted, it isn't written clearly enough. Thank you.
Next, Nick Perrone. On deck, Kim Madeja.
Hi, my name is Nick Perrone. I live here in Eldersburg. My partner and I have a property, 44 Liberty, just behind Century High School. And we're currently, it's zoned BNR, and we're currently in negotiations with a use that's permitted use. And with this new zoning, either C1 or C2, that use is being removed. So I'm requesting us to be grandfathered in for that existing use while we're negotiating right now.
Next, Kim Madeja. On deck, Jennifer Mater.
Well, well, well. I guess in the words, immortal words of Yogi Berra, it's deja vu all over again. Here we are. Our friends, our neighbors are here because we are not feeling heard. We want you to listen to us and our opinions and our concerns about the Freedom Plan. I applied to be a member of the Residential Rezoning Advisory Board because even I, a non-professional, know we cannot continue to grow with zoning codes that are over 30 years old. They have no basis in the reality of 2018 and cannot even begin to adequately address the societal and technology changes and the growth we have now. I am more convinced than ever that it is an imperative we update our antiquated codes before proceeding with this plan. For example, our current code allows for a multi-story nursing home with commercial lighting and numerous parking places in a medium residential, long-established neighborhood. That needs fixing. Sadly, our board has only been able to meet 2 times, and I hope the county plans to take the input we have for them seriously. Without more in-depth analysis of the impact of increased densities on roads, schools, and public safety, it's obvious this plan is not ready for prime time. Adopting a plan that includes a short moratorium on increasing densities seems a very logical choice. I opened with a Yogi Berra quote, and I'm going to close with one that I hope you will take to heart. If you don't know where you are going, you might end up someplace else. I, for one, love my community. I want the Freedom Area to grow in a reasonable, predictable way that mirrors the hopes and dreams of the people that live here. Let's make sure we know where we're going before we start down the wrong road.
Next, Jennifer Matter. On deck, Kathy Fuller.
Good evening. I'm Jennifer Matier. I'm joining with the vast majority of the citizens that are in attendance tonight that are saying no to the Freedom Area Master Plan. We do not want you increasing our density and urbanizing Eldersburg and turning us into another enclave of Baltimore. Planning Commission, you are not our managers. You are our public servants. Thank you.
Next, Kathy Fuller. On deck, Gary McLurdy.
I've been to all of the hearings in the town halls on the Freedom Plan over the past year or so, and some of the planning meetings. And one thing that's become quite obvious is that the residents are not being listened to. One of the realtor representatives said, all the large lot development. Well, I personally walked to 1,100 homes this spring, and I'll tell you, almost none of them were large lot homes. Most of them were reasonably sized homes and some very cute small homes. That's what a very lot of our community is, not large lot homes. So where that's coming from, I don't know. So this idea that there aren't reasonably priced houses, that's nonsense. There's lots of reasonably priced houses. Well, let's say you build all of these new high density. People move in. Guess what? There's no more reasonably priced houses because they're all filled, just like all the reasonably priced houses are filled now. But at that point, we have a much less secure, safe, drivable, usable community. We don't want these densities. Eldersburg's residents, you have to look at who's putting actual money into the hands of our elected officials who are not giving adequate direction to the Planning and Zoning Committee. Developers, realtor PACs, and special construction interests. I'm speaking to Commissioner Howard and to newly elected incoming Commissioner Rothstein. When people put money into the hands of politicians, they expect things in return. So we are asking you to deliver less development densities as the residents of this community. Will our incoming commissioner listen to the residents who voted him into office? This is our community, our homes, our safety, our investment. Please rise above the interests of out-of-county developers who donated heavily to you and represent the community you were elected to represent. The commissioners are supposed to serve the best interests of the community as the residents voice those interests. My concern is that with big development money flowing in from across the state, the voices of the residents matter very little. We don't want those densities. How many more ways and times can we say it?
Next, Gary McLurdy. On deck, Kathy Allison.
Hello, I'm Gary McLurdy, and I did speak to this very board in 2017, and I find it very strange that it's every March that the plan changes for the worse. And I don't understand why we don't have such meetings during hours when us regular working people can make them. So apparently the only time we can get together is when we can hear our voices, and then they're ignored completely. And I don't understand why that is going on. I have a lot of safety concerns about it. A lot of these places that are going to be opening up, one of them is going to be a giant intersection right across from our Freedom Elementary School. That's going to be very dangerous for all of our children. So it's wrong to be doing this, and I wish that people would pay more attention to this. And I don't believe there's enough planning giving to safety in any way. And has anybody considered the schools, the police, the fire, and everything else we need, much less the libraries and everything else that we'd like to see around? So I'm very disappointed to see that again this March, it has changed again. Now, it did save a few areas, I see, and I commend you for that. But I do know that the developers play an important part, and I wish everybody here would also understand that. I do see both sides of the coin. Now, the problem is that I don't believe adequate attention has been given to the facilities and what we need to grow adequately. Anybody in this area can tell you there's a large increase in accidents on Route 26 between the reservoir and Route 32. It's been increasing at an alarming rate, and I don't think anyone is doing anything about planning for this development. And I see more and more holes in this plan constantly when it comes to public safety. It's a real concern, and we do need to address it. And I want to let everybody else know we do need to have some growth, but I don't feel it's being managed properly. And I understand we have holes in our zoning commission, and I'd like to be part of that zoning commission, and I will be looking into getting on it. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Next, Kathy Allison, on deck, Ian Shaw.
I'm Kathy Allison. I live in Eldersburg, right off Liberty Road in what we call Freedom Village. I'm out here for some years now because my daughters have moved out to Carroll County because they like rural Carroll County to raise their families. And they left high-density living. They don't want it. I understand that. My five grandchildren are out here in Carroll County. If people want high density living, they can go to Owings Mills. I mean, there are many places they can go to. And from what I understand, high density housing doesn't bring the tax revenue that individual houses do for our county. But I'm very concerned about pushing this area into high density living. Many, many people come out here to get away from that. Thank you.
Next, Ian Shaw, and then on deck, Commissioner Richard Rothschild.
Well, good evening, folks. So thank you for all your work on this. I've served on the Planning Commission in Sykesville, and I really do appreciate your efforts. And I know how difficult it is because I worked on doing an updating our master plan. So thank you so much. I do appreciate all the efforts you put into coordinating with Sykesville through the process. The one concern that I think keeps coming back, and I didn't know if there's any way to just state on it, is the zoning, the outdated zoning pieces that everybody keeps coming back to. I'm getting a lot of questions about that. And I was just curious about how you're going to roll that out so that people, because people can't see what's inside of those zoning ordinances that are going to be reworked ahead of the plan. So it just keeps, it's like a burr in the saddle. And I don't know if there's some way to get that worked out ahead of time or what the timeline is to implement this plan before people see that. Because I know in the plan it says these will be done after the plan is approved, but that's why people are having a hard time approving, saying, okay, I'm good with the plan without knowing what's inside those zoning code. So I think that, and I've heard some other people share on it tonight. So I think that's one of the things I think we'd like to get some sort of answer to out there, like how's that process going to go? And will you be giving the right before you know what's inside? Like that was my concern from the planning perspective. Will the property owner have the right before he knows or the community knows what's allowed within that right? So that was my, and I think we keep getting that question. So hopefully you can work on that. And then commercial, if there's any opportunities, I mean, we're doing, of course, Warfield, a lot going on in Warfield. So, you know, wherever there's opportunities, you know, to bring more commercial to that site, it's a challenging site. So if you put low-hanging fruit in other places, it's going to make it harder for us. So I know commercial will go where it's going to go. Just to share with other folks, I am in real estate, and apartments don't make us money, right? So I don't bash all the realtors, because realtors, we make money selling houses, and we don't sell apartments, so at least residential realtors. So I don't know that they're getting all fired up about that. But there is a need for some diverse housing product in here. The other thing I'll say real quickly, I appreciate the efforts to work within the development process with the builders. It would be good to maybe clarify or figure out how to clarify buffers and things to these existing communities and maybe put some more emphasis on that. And while we're creating a sense of place, to maybe consider some park things inside of these communities, because that's what we do in our town, really does help you create the sense of place that we're trying to get with the Freedom Plan. And I think it'll help some of the citizens' concerns going forward too. So just want to say thank you. I know this is not an easy process. Thanks for all you guys have been doing.
Next, Commissioner Rothschild.
Good evening. As a county commissioner, I'm not going to comment on the plan. I will thank all of you for your hard work and commitment to this. I do feel to some extent like this is being part of the movie Groundhog Day when I look at some of the discussions going on here tonight. But what I am going to do is briefly share two famous quotes with you that have guided me in my 8 years in office, and I hope all of you will keep in mind as you make your final decisions. I hope my current board of commissioners will keep these quotes in mind. And I hope the new Board of Commissioners will keep these quotes in mind as they make decisions going forward, because we have a very energetic government in Maryland. The first quote is Daniel Webster. Good intentions will always be pleaded for every assumption of authority. It is hardly too strong to say the Constitution was made to guard the people against the dangers of good intentions. There are men in all ages who mean to govern well, but they mean to govern. They promise to be good masters, but they mean to be masters nonetheless, Senator Daniel Webster. And the second quote was from Christian writer C.S. Lewis. He talked about the tyranny of good intentions, and here's what he said, and I remind myself of this every day when I'm in Annapolis fighting for our people. Of all tyrannies, a tyranny sincerely exercised for the good of its victims may be the most oppressive. It would be better to live under robber barons than under omnipotent moral busybodies. The robber baron's cruelty may sometimes sleep. His cupidity may at some point be satiated. But those who torment us for our own good will torment us without end, for they do so with the approval of their own conscience. Yes, we'll probably change some densities, but Carroll County is a very fragile oasis surrounded by urban counties, and we need to protect it. Thank you.
Okay, I think everybody that wants to speak has spoken, so we will now close the public hearing.
And just as a reminder, at future Freedom meeting, or future Planning Commission meetings where Freedom may be discussed, no formal comment will be taken with regards to the plan after tonight. Thank you all for coming. Thank you.